Hey guys, how's it going? Hope you're all doing really well out there. Now today's video isn't a tutorial. Instead, we're going to talk about my experience with MicroCloud, the open source scalable cloud solution from Canonical. Now, when I say cloud, I don't mean AWS or Google Cloud exactly. MicroCloud is all about taking that cloud experience and bringing it to your own rack or even just a single PC. Now, for full transparency here, this video is sponsored by Canonical, but they've specifically asked me for my honest opinions about MicroCloud, including what I do and don't like. Also, they've actually reviewed this script and shared their thoughts with me, and we're going to cover some of their responses to what I've had to say as we go through this video. So this is kind of a collaborative effort between me and Canonical as far as the presentation is concerned. But again, these thoughts are mine, and they've been nice enough to share their responses to some of my thoughts. I'm coming at this as someone new to MicroCloud. My background in virtualization is mostly with Proxmox. So if you're discovering MicroCloud for the first time, you're not alone. So with that little intro out of the way, let's go ahead and jump in and talk about what is MicroCloud. Basically, MicroCloud is an open source platform designed to make deploying and managing virtual machines and Linux containers or LXCs straightforward. If you've used Proxmox or similar hypervisors, MicroCloud will feel familiar, but it's geared towards scalable clusters and high availability storage rather than just a single system management. Now, one thing I noticed right away is how simple the basic setup is. If you're just doing Homelab testing, you only need one server or mini PC and two hard drives. If you want to step that up and have a high availability cluster, however, you'll need at least three PCs or servers and three storage drives per node, which breaks down to one drive for the operating system, one for local storage, and one for distributed storage using MicroCeph. To get started, you just install Ubuntu server, run three or four shell commands, and you're ready to start building your cloud. This was remarkably easy and was a welcome surprise compared to other platforms that I've used in the past. Now, a while back, we did a live stream where we installed Ubuntu server on three mini PCs for an upcoming project, and this is that project. Since then, I've been deploying various instances on my little cluster, and this includes Ubuntu server and desktop VMs, plus a few custom turnkey ISOs, more on that in a moment, just to see what all I could do with this setup. The selection of preloaded base images in MicroCloud is actually pretty decent, which makes deploying different environments pretty simple. Just a couple of clicks, and you're spinning up a VM or an LXC in no time at all. Now that said, I did bump into some quirks with custom ISO installs. For example, to get Turnkey and some other ISOs working, I had to disable Secure Boot and enable CSM. And that's not unusual if you've ever gone deep with VM customization, but it is a good thing to know for anyone venturing off the beaten path. Setting up a VM or an LXC is actually pretty logical. You name them, jot down a quick description, and pick a base images. You can upload your own ISO, but there's a point for a wish list here as far as I'm concerned. Unlike Proxmox, you can't just dump in a remote URL and let MicroCloud download the ISO for you, so you need to upload the ISO manually, which definitely adds a step. When I talked to Canonical about this, they told me that they didn't feel the need to prioritize it intentionally because they want to provide the users with a cloud-like experience, hence the built-in image library. They went on to say, think about how you would launch an instance in AWS. There'd be no ISO involved. In MicroCloud, it's still an option, but it's not something that's meant to be a primary use case. And while it's not how I like to do things, I can appreciate where they're coming from while trying to bring a cloud experience in home. Now, something I did actually find pretty frustrating initially was that if you run into an error when creating an instance, the error message just flies by really fast. At first, I missed these and would go back and start my instance rebuild from scratch. Later, I found, though, that clicking the error message let me go back and adjust my settings instead of having to start over each time. Now, just a quick note based on my experience when testing and writing this script. It seems that the default way MicroCloud is meant to be managed, based on documentation anyway, is via the command line. And when I'm learning a new platform like this, I generally like to learn it via a GUI or a graphical user interface. But in order to do that with MicroCloud, you have to create a trust token via the command line by following instructions in the browser. It does only take a moment, but it is something that you have to do on each computer that you want to use to administer your cluster in the browser, which is actually probably a good thing so that not just any Yahoo who accesses your IP in their browser can manage your cluster. Now, Canonical also had some input on this that I wanted to share with you as well. They said, on the UI versus CLI, it is true that our current documentation places more emphasis on the command line. And this is due to historical reasons, as LXD, which is the main element of MicroCloud, has existed for about 8 years without a dedicated graphical user interface. And we have some catching up to do documentation-wise to make sure that the GUI is sufficiently highlighted. CLI is the way you deploy it, and you need to set up either a certificate or SSO via the OIDC provider in order to use the GUI. But it's absolutely up to the user to manage MicroCloud in whatever way they prefer. And we've been investing quite a lot of effort in making sure that the GUI has all of the features users are expected to utilize. So to kind of sum up some of the documentation here, if you're a seasoned professional in data centers and in enterprise stuff with AWS and Azure, you shouldn't have any issue with the documentation. But if you're new to this or not familiar with AWS and Azure and cloud hosting, you can expect a bit of Google foo and forum hopping. The official docs do cover all of the features, but more step-by-step guides or troubleshooting flows for beginners would be really, really nice to have. Now, Canonical did mention that there are more features and guides on the way, so hopefully that'll help smooth out the onboarding process. One of the main selling points of MicroCloud is the high availability storage with Ceph, and this is available out of the box, but here's something to be aware of. High availability of the instances themselves, the LXCs and the VMs, isn't included with MicroCloud. If you want your containers or VMs to automatically recover when a server goes down, you'll need extra software and configuration. And when I asked MicroCloud engineers about this, they told me that while LXD supports a cluster healing feature, which can automatically evacuate workloads from a failed node, there are some known issues, especially with fencing nodes. So they aren't actively recommending this feature just yet. Also, there are plans to add more cluster events for external applications to react to, but for now, just know that instance failover isn't a default feature. So let's talk networking for just a moment here. Networking in MicroCloud is different than what I'm used to in Proxmox. Proxmox, by default, lets each LXC or VM that you deploy grab an IP from your main network's DHCP. In MicroCloud, OVN, that's Open Virtual Network, provides a cluster-wide default network with its own subnet. So instances get IPs from that shared subnet and can move freely between cluster members. That said, if you want to expose a VM or service to your LAN, you'll need to set up network forwarding in MicroCloud. Alternatively, you can define network bridges on each cluster member using the same name like BR0 and create a profile that uses this bridge configuration instead of the OVN default. This way, your instances can connect directly to your home network and get IPs from your home DHCP server. Now, for someone like me with less networking experience, this was more confusing than it was helpful at first. But if you're coming from an enterprise background, the default networking may make a lot more sense to you. But that said, in a home network, it might take some extra steps to get things working how you want them to work. Now, I went with the port forwarding option and was then able to access running services via the mini PC's IP address and the port number of the desired application. But you may want to take a different approach in your setup to whatever makes the most sense for how you're deploying things. I also tested remote tunneling to access hosted services on a domain, and everything ran really smoothly. You'd never guess the site was running from a cluster of small PCs in my office, because the performance was actually pretty excellent. And a couple of things I think would make MicroCloud even better, especially for Homelab users. First, I wish there was a dedicated dashboard that more easily showed resource usage for each piece of hardware, like RAM, CPU, and network. Something actually similar to the instance page with the stats of individual instances. Even if it's just a better clustering page, seeing the health and activity at a glance would be a super nice feature to have for each of your different nodes. Also, networking could be more intuitive for home labbers who aren't great with networking. I'd love it if nodes and instances could just grab an IP from my normal DHCP server a bit more easily, and then let me set it static if I want. Now look, I know that this isn't ideal in a production server environment, but I think it would be helpful for testing in a Homelab setup. So what are my final thoughts? Honestly, what surprised me the most was how easy it was to get MicroCloud installed and clustered. With Proxmox, I spent a lot of time wrangling the UI to get my storage and clusters set up. MicroCloud, on the other hand, made that process a lot easier, which I truly appreciated. While MicroCloud is simple to set up and it runs great, I probably won't be replacing my Proxmox Homelab just yet. My Proxmox setup is already working the way I want, and MicroCloud still feels like it's finding its place for users like me. For people new to Homelabbing, MicroCloud's enterprise focus shows in its documentation and networking setup. I would definitely recommend experimenting with lots of different platforms to see what fits your needs. So while MicroCloud may not be something that I'll be implementing in my setup, I would love to know if it's something that you've used or heard of, or if you're currently using it now. I would love to know all of that in the comment section down below. So that's my experience with MicroCloud. If you've got questions or want a deeper dive into specific features, or have your own stories to share, definitely let me know down in the comments. Thanks again to Canonical for sponsoring this video and encouraging honest feedback. Also, thanks to you guys for spending a few minutes of your day with me here today. I'll talk to you in the next video.